So here we have this example. We have four items, which are all rated by Alice and four users, user one through user four. And we want to find out about item five, which users one through four are rated, but Alice is not. We want to know whether Alice will like that item or not. And here is where we're going to use the Pearson method. And we have various, we even deciding to use Pearson's a non-trivial decision. And we, as we see, well, it's a rather trivial, I should say simple, and simplicity is always good. This base simplicity, the actual algorithm we end up with is going to have lots of features built into it, so it'll actually be quite complex. But the principles underlying each of those methods probably should be simple. We need to know how many neighbors, how many users we should consider. The neighbors, remember, we're going to choose the users which are near Alice. We're not so interested in users which in the past have always rated things very differently from Alice, because we have no idea how to use those users significantly. So these are nearest neighbor algorithms. We're trying to find users like Alice. And then once we've found those users, we have to know how to average over their predictions of this unknown item five to get what Alice wants. So this is user-based collaborative filtering. We use the Pearson correlation, which is written down here. It sort of looks pretty obvious. We have we're finding the distance between users. Remember, we're trying to, I told you, we're having spaces here. We have the space of where the points are users. We're trying to find the distance between those users. And so we do that by looking at all items rated by each of these. We try to find distance between any two users, A and B. We look at all items rated by both A and B, and then we form this this rather obvious correlation function. It's just the sum of the rating, sum over items which are rated by both A and B, the rating of A times the rating of B minus the average rating. So we're trying to take out the fact that some users might be grumpy and always rate things low. Some items might be idyllically happy and rate things always very high, but still the differences are significant. We get rid of those things by doing this normalized measure here. And this is designed so that if A and B are very similar, we will get a similarity of 1. Because if A and B are similar, RA of P equals RB of P, means are the same. And you will find out that this similarity is defined here is exactly 1. So similarity of 1, A and B are similar. Similarity of minus 1, they're really very different. So now we can see what happens for these examples here. And we find that Alice and user one are very similar, although user one tends to be grumpier than Alice and rates his or her items lower than Alice, but still the normalized similarity is high. User two is hardly any correlation. User three has high correlation again. And user four is really very different from Alice. You can see that user four and item one is rates item one very badly at a 1, and Alice rates item one as a 5. And items 2 and 3, Alice is a very optimistic lady. She likes everything very high. But user 4 is a grumpy person. But you can see there's a clear anti-correlation between user 4 and Alice, which is reflected by the Pearson similarity being minus 0.79. And this graph here is meant to point out that user one and user four are quite different. Namely, user four, the purple, is high for 2 and 3, items 2 and 3, and low for items 1 and 4. User one is almost the opposite, and Alice is almost the opposite. You can see, apart from the normalization factor, Alice and user one are pretty similar, which is why their similarity, normalized similarity, comes out so similar. And this is empirically found to be a very good, best measure, and it seems to me reasonably intuitively satisfactory. And then once we have these similarities, we want to decide what Alice's ratings is. And we're trying to predict what A is, Alice, and B is in, say, user one, somebody similar to Alice. Then we take this weighted sum, which you can see again tries to take into account the fact that Alice rates things highly. So we add in her average rating, and we take account of user B's discrepancy from his or her average. And so again, this is not a mathematically demanded form, but it's pretty sensible form that you'd expect to work. It's a weighted, it's corrected for the different average ratings of the two users, but otherwise is just the average of the ratings of B, weighted by the similarity between A and B. And then that weighting is designed to sum up to one. When you look at the B, we weight the contribution of each user B by the similarity between A and B. But at the bottom, we take the sums. We're only going to sum over users B, which are near A, so the similarities are all going to be positive. We're not going to try to sum over or possible similarities, given this thing at the bottom might be near zero, and then we'll get garbage. So implicitly, there's an assumption we only look at the users who are near each other. So there are various, obviously, there's been years of research, some of it in the open literature, probably most of it secretly inside these companies, which try to optimize with all sorts of heuristics how you do this. This is not a field I work on, so I don't have a lot of value. This slide here comes from greater experts than me, and it shows how you can add different weights. You have a selection formula for the number of neighbors, which is either a fixed number of neighbors, or you use a similarity threshold. If the similarity is greater than 0.7, you'll include them, and otherwise you won't, something like that. And there's an issue here about the long tail, namely, if everybody likes something, then the fact that you agree on that is not as useful as a case where there's a wider variation of opinion. That's why they say you give more weights to items that have larger variance. So that's the end of this, this lecture. And in the next lecture, we will discuss these things in more detail, and we'll also discuss some software issues. Thank you very much. Remember, these algorithms are tens or maybe, I don't know how many billions of dollars. They're hugely important in driving lifestyle or commerce informatics. Thank you very much.